Good evening. Good to be back. Sorry for the last 2 weeks I wasn't here. I was in Israel. Coming back to the cold weather, as you can see, affecting me. Baruch Hashem. I want to start with good news. My book came out so far in Hebrew only, but in a month or two, it will be available in English. It's like they say in English, the greatest hits, the best parts that we took from many, many, I don't know, thousands of lectures, key moments of the lectures that we chose from many, many thousand options into one book. And yesterday in my lecture, I went over the index, what topics are in the books. If you watch last night's lecture, which will be on tonight, you can get an idea what is it about. But one thing I promise you is that anyone that is not religious, that you give him this book, there's a very high chance he will become observant and keep the mitzvot. Also, people that are semi-religious, they need this. Also, people that are very religious, they also need this. So everyone needs it from a different point of view, but it's definitely going to help every one of us. Tomorrow it's Purim, meaning tomorrow we're going to fast, Ta'anit Esther, and then right into the reading of the Megillah. Purim is a very special holiday. It's a rabbinical holiday. It's not a holiday that is in the Torah, even though there is a hint in the Torah about Purim. But it's a rabbinical holiday, just like Hanukkah. Hanukkah is rabbinical. Purim is rabbinical. Rosh Hashanah, Kippur, Sukkot, Pesach, Shavuot, they're all holidays from the Torah. But Purim, it's a rabbinical holiday. And there's a very interesting Gemara in Yerushalmi says that when Mashiach comes, the Atid Lavo, the future to come, all the holidays will be dismissed, but the holiday of Purim will always remain. And that's raised right away serious questions, because it looks like a contradiction from every other thing we learn. One of the solid rules and one of the principles of Judaism is that the Torah will never ever be changed. You can never change a letter from the Torah, nothing. And therefore, to say that in the future to come, when Mashiach come, the holidays will be dismissed, and may brings the wrong idea to some people. So, I want to relax you. There's no contradiction in the Torah, neither in the Gemara. What they really mean is the significance of the holidays will be reduced tremendously. Let me explain. Since we cannot change one law of the Torah, and once Mashiach comes, we will still have all the laws of the Torah, those who are relevant. Some of the mitzvot will not be relevant when Mashiach comes. I'll give you some examples from the top of my head. One is, after Mashiach come, and Hashem will clean all the wicked people from the world, non-Jews and Jews, right? And that time, there's not going to be any more Amalek. That's it. Hashem clean Amalek from the world. So here is one mitzvah from the Torah, which will not be relevant anymore. We're going to live here in the time of Mashiach for many, many years, and there's not going to be Amalek to kill. By the way, in case you didn't realize, this mitzvah is already not relevant for over 2,000 years. Meaning, there was a king named Sancheriv, and in his time there was a lot of wars, and he made everybody run for their life. And people were moving from one country to another, and that makes all the goyim, all the Gentiles, mix with each other. So today, over 2,000 years later, you don't know anymore who is Amalek, who is Ishmael, who is Philistine, you don't know anything. So every goy you meet, there could be any kind of goy. It can be Amalek, it can be Philistine, it can be, different. So So therefore, there's no way to know. Since there's no way to know, there's no more mitzvah of erasing the memory of Amalek, meaning practical mitzvah, there's no such thing, because every goy, there's a doubt. You cannot kill someone if there's a doubt who he is, right? So therefore, this mitzvah practically cannot be done. However, Hashem, of course, knows who is Amalek and who is not. And when Mashiach comes, a part of cleaning the world will be cleaning Amalek from the earth. It's written in Zohar, in Kabbalah, that the name of Hashem will never be fully complete. You know, hypothetically speaking, it will not be fully complete until he will erase any memory of this filthy nation called Amalek. Yesterday I spoke a lot why Hashem hates Amalek so much. I don't want to go into that now, because I have a lot of different things to talk about that will take a lot of time. But yesterday I explained why from all the Gentiles in the world, some of them Hashem likes, some of them he does not like, and some of them he hates, and Amalek he hates more than anyone. Just like among us, the Jewish people. Some of us he loves very much, some of us he likes, some of us he does not like, some of us he hates, depend what we do. By us, it's not by who we are, because we all Jews. By us is how we behave. If you're going to be a murderer, or a Mechalel Shabbos, or an idol worshiper, or a big thief, don't expect Hashem to be crazy in love with you. All right? To put it in an understatement. It's written clearly that some people Hashem hates. Whenever people argue with you with the phony, rotten approach of their kiruv and tell you Hashem loves everyone, Hashem loves all Jews, open to them Rambam in Ilchot Shuvah, the top authority in Jewish halacha and ideology, and read to them what the Rambam says. That's the end of the argument. Yesterday, before you became religious, he was hated, despicable, pushed away, meaning literally, in simple English, I cannot even look at you. Not only I cannot stand you, I can't even look at you. Like they say in America, get out of my face. And today, after he became Baal Tshuva, he's loved and welcome and pulled closer. Simple Hebrew. You don't need to be a professor to understand that. Yesterday Hashem could not stand you. Why? You were Mechalel Shabbat. Why? You lived with a non-Jewish woman. Your children are goyim. Why you're a big thief? Why all day you speak Lashon Hara? There's enough reasons why he doesn't like you. And today you stop, you regret, you shame, you improve your way, you think differently, you change your rotten ideology with a positive ideology, you improve your modesty, you're more generous, you're helping others, you're not selfish anymore. Ooh, there's a long list. Baruch Hashem, you're in the process of fixing it, even though you're not still perfect. The fact you got on the right highway to the right direction already puts you in a much better position than before. Like the famous machloket of the Rambam and Rabbeinu Yonah, two top authorities, they both lived around the same time, 850 years ago. And Rambam say, who is considered a classy Baal Tshuva? Someone that went all the way back to Hashem, because it's written in the Torah, "Veshavta ad Hashem Elokecha veshamata bekolo." You have to return all the way to your God, not halfway, not two-thirds, not a quarter way, all the way to your God, meaning put all your efforts and get all the way to the top that you can, top potential that you have. And that's called a Baal Tshuva. Rabbeinu Yonah say, of course, obviously, that's a perfect Baal Tshuva. But Baal Tshuva can be even someone who did not go all the way. He's only a third way in his journey. But he already moved from the wrong direction into the right direction. Meaning, he's progressing as we speak. Meaning, now, if Mashiach would come now, while he's in the middle of his way, he did not arrive yet. He's already considered one of the Baalei Tshuva. He will be punished, of course, for what he did not fix yet. Don't get me wrong. In the end, everyone must pay for what they did wrong. But there's a whole different look at him. Now you already found your way to me. Meaning, even though you're very far still, you change your direction into the positive direction, and you are constantly moving and progressing. הרי זה מתייצב על דרכי התשובה. I made a whole series just about, you know, this. It's called the psychology of the mind and the soul. Over there I went into all the details about it. So this is it. So if somebody tells you, oh, no, don't listen to this. Hashem loves everyone. We all his children. Yes, we all his children. And yes, the father has a natural love to his children. It's all true. But it's written. You cannot argue with what's written. If you're going against me, rebel against me, and you're going to be a criminal, you're going to be in my blacklist. Blacklist meaning when the judgment day come, I will claim every little sin you made, needless to say, the big ones, from you and severely punish you for that. Unless you're going to make a serious repentance, tshuva, you stop, you regret, you'll be ashamed, you make confessions every day, few Yom Kippur will pass, you're going to get some sufferings for some of the serious sins, you're going to give lots of donations. Donations is a very good trick. It takes away a lot of suffering. Remember this. We are very spoiled people. We are not physically strong and definitely not mentally. And especially if we live here in America with luxurious lifestyle like most of the Jews and people in general. So when we begin to suffer, it destroys us. Why? If you live in a very bad, serious area that is poverty and difficult life and war and pressure, okay, you're used to it. You grew up like that. And when you grow up in nice places, Muncie, Flatbush, Great Neck, Lakewood, all these places, you live in a nice, comfortable lifestyle, you always have money for what you need, you know, families next to you, you know, nice clothing, nice cars, I mean, everything you need, 1, 2, 3, you get, cleaning ladies, I don't know, you know, you name it. So once we begin to suffer, even with a small sickness that bothers us constantly, we take it very strong to the heart. Why? Because we're not used to it. So it can break us mentally. So what's the solution? The easiest solution is to give tons of money to tzedakah. Tons. Especially the rich people. If they're smart, they will always give a lot of money to tzedakah. Why? Because the more they give, the less suffering they're going to get. When the Satan comes to Hashem and says, this guy deserves a real serious punishment and suffering for all the years he was mechalel Shabbat, for all the things he did in his life, for all his sex crimes. So right away, your defender, the lawyer that defends you in Shamayim, the Malach, he will right away make a good claim. Say, yes, you're right, he deserves for this, we cannot argue. But he already paid for it. Look, he gave thousands of dollars every month for tzedakah. He cares about other people, he brings them closer to Hashem, he works very hard for his money, he has a lot of stress at work, he has a lot of tension. So after he makes so much money, he takes a big portion of his money, which caused him a lot of suffering, and he gives it out to strangers. Why would he give more suffering? He already gave suffering to help others. Why are you going to give him double suffering? You understand? But if he gives nothing, he keeps everything for himself and for his own children, what kind of suffering he had? This is for his selfishness. He don't deserve anything. So that's a very good way to redeem a lot of problems, cancers and all kinds of mental issues and divorce problems and raising children problems. Why, Hashem, you don't need to punish me. I already punish myself by working very hard and I take the money and I give it out. So I do it for you. Why would you punish me? Right away, the Satan is mute. He has no claim anymore. You understand? So that's why the Gemara is full of it. Tzedakah, not only tatzil mimavet, Tzedakah can even save from a decree of death. Meaning on Rosh Hashanah, Hashem signed that this year he dies, and he decided to give a lot of tzedakah, and all of a sudden Hashem pulled the note back and gave him another 20 years of life. Which we have cases like this in the Tanakh. Why? The power of charity. By the way, some people gave a lot of charity in their life and they expected miracles to happen, and the miracles not exactly happened. So what happened is results. They stop or they lower the amount. That's a very big mistake. Why? Because you can never go wrong with giving charity. Even if you give and give and give and give, and one day you lose all your money and you became poor. The money you gave already, it's already yours for eternity. That you have to look at it from the other way around. Oh, at least that money I saved. At least some of my money I saved. Now I lost all my money. But Baruch Hashem, I gave $1 million to tzedakot. This one I did not lose. What do you mean? You don't have it in your bank account. You need it now for food. Yes. But this money I could have lost also. But now at least I already have mitzvot that I purchased with that. That's already waiting for me for the life of eternity. So you have to be very happy. Not like some people, they speak because of lack of understanding and total ignorance. They say, why did it help me all the tzedakah I gave? I've been giving and giving, in the end, one day I lost all my money. Is that fair? You fool. It's more than fair. Because Hashem loved you, you were supposed to lose all your money. But because you gave a lot of tzedakah, now you're losing much less. I'll give you an example. The Gemara says, Rabbi Yochanan had two nephews. They were rich. The nephews came to him one time, and he said to them, you know, they said to him, Rabbi, the Romans were police, Romans were the army, Romans were the IRS also. They collect taxes from the Jews, from every country they occupied, people have to pay them taxes. You don't pay them taxes, you die, or you go to jail. They came to him and they say, Rabbi, the Roman came to us, to our business. They want us to pay them 700 coins of gold. It's a lot of money. Coins of gold. Imagine it's like an ounce of gold. It's almost $1 million in our day. Fine. We have to pay them tax and fine. What are we going to do? So he said to them, give $683, 83 coins of gold, 683 coins of gold to the yeshiva, to the guys that learn Torah, and don't worry about it. Everything will be fine. So they said, you sure? Yeah. So they went and gave the money. Today, if they come to a rabbi, say, Rabbi, the IRS want from me $700,000, fine. So the rabbi will tell you, okay, give my yeshiva $683,000 and everything will be fine. 2 minutes later, it will be in New York Times. Corrupted rabbi is a crook, takes advantage on me. I came to cry to him, he wants more money, right? Baruch Hashem, the people were not like today. The rabbi say to give, no question asked. Right away, they gave the money. Say, so what should we do now? He say, next time when the guy come, put 17 coins of gold on a plate and put it there and say, we taking care of you. Here, just offer him the 17, he'll take it and everything will be fine. Okay. When the guy came, they put 17 coins. He said, no problem, case dismissed. He took for his pocket, case dismissed. Nothing has changed in the world since then until today. It's still working this way, by the way. But anyway, they came to him and they said, Rabbi, okay, we did what you told us, and Baruch Hashem, it worked out. The question is, how did you know? What, your prophet? He said to them, few days before you came to me, I said, I had a dream that you're going to lose 700 coins of gold. That's, you gotta lose it. So since I already knew you're going to lose it, I told you first, give it 683, and then give 17 to the guy, together it's 700. That's it, you're not gonna lose a penny more than that. So they say, okay, so if you knew about it in advance, why you didn't tell us to give to the yeshiva the whole 700 coins of gold? Isn't it a shame to give to this crook 17 coins of gold? It's a lot of money. He said, I wanted to see how the dream comes through. If I would tell you to give, you know, all 700, we would not know if it's thanks to me or not. Now I know exactly how it worked. Understand? So here is an example. He could have lost 700. They could have lost 700. But now they gave to tzedakah a lot. So they really, in the end, only lost 17. Why? 683 went to the Olam Haba. But if they would say to him, no, we don't give tzedakah. Now, business is so bad now. We have problems with IRS. You're telling us to give a lot of tzedakah. Right? So the answer is, no, now it's the time to give. And that's how you prove Hashem, that you trust Him. And that's very difficult. The test in Emunah is very difficult. You don't have such a big audience to walk like that. You know? Yeah, maybe you come half an hour later, then you can make a show. Yes, I guess. All right, so now. So what we have over here now is going back to what I started. So the question we have to ask, why in Purim, it will remain forever, but all the other holidays will be significantly reduced. Like I say, you cannot change one law of the Torah. Some of the laws of the Torah are not relevant. Like when Mashiach comes, that's it. You're not going to have to erase the memory of Amalek. You may never have Korban Asham. There's Korban Asham. When you make a sin intentionally, some of the sins, you have to bring a sacrifice. Since it's not going to be Yetzer Hara, you're not going to make any sin intentionally. So you won't have this Korban. So here you go. Another one of the Taryag Mitzvot is not going to be relevant. Also, Puruvu, to have children. This is the first mitzvah in the Torah. You're not going to have it. Why? Because there's not going to be any more reincarnations. There's no more wicked people waiting to come back to the world. That's it. Only the righteous survive. And all the wicked are lost. So who's going to come? What souls? The souls that are righteous are already redeemed. And they're already saved. And they're already here. And even those who died, they came back to life. Resurrection of the dead. So all the souls of all the righteous people are already back to life. And all the wicked people are permanently destroyed. There's no more test. So what you don't have children anymore. That's it. And nobody dies anymore. So you understand what's going to happen? It's going to be a whole different world. However, the mitzvot of the Torah, for instance, you're going to have Korban Chatat. When a person makes a not intentional sin, that the punishment for that is karet, he has to bring Korban Chatat. Like if you, by mistake, broke Shabbat. You didn't know it's not allowed, or you forgot it's Shabbat, or you just woke up in the morning, you know, you're still dizzy, and you turn on the lights, and now you just realize, wow, it's Shabbat, I have to go to shul. What did I do? Forgot it's Shabbat. It can happen. So what would happen in the time of Bet HaMikdash? We don't have Yetzer Hara. No problem. So we don't make sins intentionally, but mistakenly, it's nothing to do with the evil inclination. It's an innocent mistake. Sins that we do on purpose come from our evil inclination, Yetzer Hara. But sins that we do not intentionally doesn't come from Yetzer Hara. Come from innocent mistake. You turn on the light, not because you want to go against Hashem, or because you want to break Shabbat, because you forgot it's Shabbat. Or you did something you may not know about, or you just realized it wasn't allowed. You did not do it on purpose. Only things that you do on purpose comes from the evil inclination. So now we're still going to have Korban Chatat. Because we're still going to be making Chilulei Shabbat by mistake. And we can still do other things that not intentionally, and we're going to have to repent for it. So here you go. This is another example. However, Rabotai, we still have to understand why all the holidays will be dismissed and Purim will remain forever. It's a little bit strange for a few reasons. Reason number one, all the holidays are from God, and Purim is from the rabbis, from human beings. So what, you put human being above God? You said the laws of God, the holidays that God gave us, will be reduced or dismissed, and then the holiday that the rabbis made will remain forever? That's question number one. Question number two, what is the difference between Purim and all the other holidays? So let's explain. Why do we have Sukkot? Why do we have Pesach? Why do we have Shavuot? Why do we have all these holidays? Everything is Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, memory of the Exodus of Egypt. Why put Filin? Memory of the Exodus of Egypt. Every mitzvah almost, Zikaron, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. Shabbat, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. Matzah, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. Sukkah, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. Korban Pesach, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. So many mitzvot, Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. The memory of the Exodus of Egypt. Now, Yetziat Mitzrayim, the Exodus of Egypt, what was it? It was a temporary salvation. Yes, it's already 3,300 years. Baruch Hashem, since we got saved. But everybody understands that it's a temporary salvation. Meaning, first, not everyone got saved. 80% died. Second, those who got saved permanently or suffering already 3,300 years, pogroms and exiles and wars and problems and destruction of the temple and going again to exile. The salvation was incomplete. It was good for X amount of years. We got the Torah, we came to Israel, we built Beit HaMikdash. What happened right after? Came the Babylonians, destroyed the Beit HaMikdash, made us slaves, send us to Babylon. How do you have Jews in Babel? Talmud Bavli, Babylonian Talmud. The Babylonian threw us from Israel to Iraq. That's it. So the salvation was incomplete. It was only for X amount of years and we back to square one. Finished with the Egyptians, we went to the Babylonians. Finished with the Babylonians, we went to the Persians and Haman. Finished with the Persians and Haman, we went to the Greeks. Finished with the Greeks, we went to the Romans. Finished with the Romans, we have the Ishmaelim, the Arabs. For 1400 years, since they have this Quran that they made up. But the problems with the Arabs started way before. So we don't have a moment of rest. So what kind of salvation is that? So when Mashiach will come and Hashem will purify the world and it's not going to be any more evil Gentiles, only righteous Gentiles that love Jews and will never ever fight them, and it's not going to be any more liberal Jews and no more lefty traders and not all these people who make fun at the religion and at the rabbis and make comments in the internet, all these evil Jews, they're not going to remain in the world. Hashem will clean all these evil people from the earth. There's not going to be anything evil. Nothing, even among the animals. It's going to be a peaceful war. All the nations will put their army on a strike, permanent strike. All the weapons will go to the garbage. Nobody will ever need it. They're going to live. It's written clearly by the prophet that the armies would leave their weapon for good. Nobody would need no nuclear anymore, no chemical weapon, no guns, no nothing. So the world will be beautiful. There's no evil inclination. No one is dying. No new babies. No hassle. Nobody has to work for a living. There will be wealth like picking up sand from the ground. Ma'adanim etzuim ke'afar. Rambam writes that there will be such a world that you don't have to ever bother. Remember, 2/3 of the people of the world are already died. Only 1/3 left. And this 1/3 will not be left forever. They will have a grace period. And from the 1/3, many also will die. So maybe in the end, will be 20% left, 10% left. It's not going to be that much. Instead of 7.5 billion that we have now, maybe we're going to have 1 billion left between Jews and the righteous Goyim. And all the people that will come back from all the previous generation, maybe it's going to be 1 billion people. So now you have so much wealth in the world. Remember, there's so much wealth, but there's much less people. So it's plenty. Nobody has to worry. Everything like the time of the desert. You have food, you have everything. You don't have to worry about anything. Everybody learns Torah to the highest level with no interference. No fighting, no evil inclination, no going to work, no IRS issues, no court issues, lawyers, meeting, problems in the marriage, problems with the children, drugs addiction, none of these things. Try to imagine what the life is going to be. For how long? Until the year 7,000. We are now 5,778. So how many more years we have? Mashiach must come within 6,000 years. But the Gemara say, the Chachamim say, the Ramban writes on the Pasuk, in Shir HaShirim, Ha'elef Lecha Shlomo U'matayim Lanotrim, that it has to be at least 200 years before the year 6,000. Meaning maximum 5,800. So if we are in 5,778, that means there are only 22 years left for our days. Most of us are young here, so we should be alive in 22 years to see all these miracles that are written by the prophets. So now, if Mashiach does come in the next 22 years, how many years is going to be left? 1,200 years. Without sicknesses, without wars, without Arabs to kill us, without terrorism, without all of that. No anti-Semitism, no racism. Racist people, for instance, they're very big sinners. They're not going to be around. Someone hates other Jews because they're a different color, or they have different accent, or they came from a different country, or they have different customs. That's not a righteous person. The opposite. The fact that he's religious and knows how much Hashem hates lack of unity, and he makes constantly separations between Jews based on stupidity. If you separate righteous people from wicked people, you don't want your children to go to your brother's house because over there it's Sodom and Gomorrah. So no, you're not going to get punished for that. You're going to get rewarded for it. That your brain overcome your heart. Your heart says, family, how am I going to say to my brother, we cannot come to him? But the brain says, I'm sorry, I have to protect the souls of my children. Brother or no brother, he's not going to save us from getting home. Right? So that's a hard test. For that, you're going to get a huge reward. But if you don't want to go there because you are Ashkenazi and he's Sfaradi, or the other way around, then you're a very big criminal. If you dream that you see Mashiach and you're going to have Olam Haba, stop dreaming. Hashem cannot stand people like you. You have to wake up. You have to realize you have to love the tzaddikim and you have to hate the haters of Hashem. Those who fight the Torah, those who fight the rabbis, those who fight religion, you have permission to hate them. Regardless who they are, Sfaradi, Ashkenazi, Temani, or Hasid. It's nothing to do with this. You are tzaddik, I love you. Why? Because you're a lover of Hashem. You Rasha, you're a fighter against God, I hate you. Why? It's written in the Tanakh. Mesanecha Hashem esna. David HaMelech told us, mitzvah to hate those who hate God. Mitzvah to hate those who rebel against him. Not a mitzvah, to hate a Jew that doesn't know anything about God. Meaning he does a lot of sins. But not because he's a criminal, because he doesn't know any better. Then here you have to be very careful. You cannot hate someone like that. But if you know this guy was in yeshiva, or he grew up in a religious family, and now he became anti-Torah and fights the religion, mitzvah to hate him. And don't let anybody else fool you, please. Enough with this politically correct garbage. Mitzvah to hate him, mitzvah to stay away from him, mitzvah not to be in touch with him in any possible way. He wants to do tshuva, we run to help you. You want to stay a clown, we don't want anything to do with you. That's the rule. So, going back to what I say. So now we understand why when Mashiach comes and it's going to be a final salvation, which after this salvation there's not going to be any more exiles. And no goyim will ever bother us. And we will never ever go out of Israel anymore. And the third temple that we build will never be destroyed. So this salvation will be so perfect and eternal that the salvation of Passover will look like nothing compared to this salvation. So if you had until now a gold coin that you're holding so much to it, and you just got a huge diamond worth a million times more, you care about the gold coin? You don't care about it a minute after that. Why? Because you got a 20-carat diamond. And as long as I didn't have the diamond, the gold was everything I have. I grabbed it every minute of my life. Now when I got this diamond, take the coin. I don't need it, Bichlal. Here, a gift for you. Tip. Why? Why? Because there's nothing to compare. Okay, so this part we understand. So now we understand why Passover will be dismissed, meaning the significance of Pesach will not be like now. It will be a whole different thing. Same thing Sukkot, because it's also the Exodus of Egypt. Everything. But we still have to understand the question, why Purim will remain?
Because Purim is the holiday when the Am Yisrael constantly accept the Torah.
Shavuot is also. What's the difference?
Constantly means that they have a time of thinking and deciding that they will accept it. That's why that they decided to be really connected to Hashem constantly. That's why this holiday will be.
I tell you what you're saying is incorrect, but I know what you're trying to say. What you're trying to say is that once we got the Torah in Shavuot, a minute later we change our mind, right? After we say Naaseh v'Nishma, right after that we change our mind. So what happened? Hashem forced us.
No, that's not what I was
saying. Wait, let me finish. So Hashem forced us. Kafa aleihem ha'ar kegigit. He said, if you're not going to accept what you just promised, here you're going to be all buried. Meaning they didn't have a choice. They had fear. But later in Purim, after the miracle, they all accepted the Torah willingly, not by fear or force. So that's a very high level. That's why they call Purim Yom HaKippurim, which is a very special holy day. Kippurim means Kepurim, like Purim. Kepurim means like Purim, meaning is holy like Purim, meaning Purim is higher. And some says that the prayers of the day of Purim is the most significant and helpful prayers of the year. Meaning, whatever you pray for, you have a very high chance to get on a day of Purim. But I still, that's not the answer to my question. It's true, but it's not the answer to my question. The answer to my question, why Purim will remain but Hanukkah won't? If you wanted to give credit to the rabbis, to show their importance, like it says in Parashat Shoftim, everything they tell you, you must listen to them. Don't move left and right from everything they will instruct you. And if you will, there's a death penalty for it. You made a very good point here. The rabbis are me. You mess with them, you mess with me. Okay, we got it. Now you want to show that you were serious about it. So you say, my holidays will be reduced. But the holidays the rabbi made will remain forever. Okay, but it's not the case. In that case, it should be Purim and Hanukkah. Why only Purim? Hanukkah, we also had salvation from the Greeks. The answer, Rabotai, is Purim was also a perfect salvation. Hanukkah wasn't a perfect salvation. In Hanukkah, Jews died. There was a war. In Hanukkah, most of the Jews became goyim, mityavnim. Became what they call today reform, conservative, and some other orthodox. Became more goyim than Jews. So they made us a huge damage. I say that the Greeks won everything. We did not win anything. I cannot contradict Chazal, and I cannot contradict Hanukkah. But I say that the Greeks are in Gehenom. They are in hell for 2,500 years. And one thing they're very proud of, we made all the Jews Greeks. Sports, luxury, chandeliers, sport cars, watches, diamonds, competitions, stadiums. What is this? It's all Greeks. Not to talk about the Greek ideology, mythology, all their nonsense. that you have to be strong and beautiful and handsome and muscular and remove hair and have curly hair and put gel in your hair. How many Jews you know that don't have gel in hair when they leave the house? Go here. Find how many, besides the Hasidim. Maybe the Hasidim put in their peot. You know? So, who invented all this culture? The Greeks. Who invented competition, fighting, boxing, wrestling? All the Greeks. All Olympic. What's the word Olympic? Where does it come from? Olympia. That's the Greeks. Sport. Sparta. The Greeks. So who won? Of course the Greeks. Who are you fooling? Yes, they're all dead and they're all in hell. Yes. But the venom that they injected into us is still live and kicking. You can say whatever you want, but that's the truth. Argue. Reality, that's what happened. So, besides the fact that the Greek made a huge damage, and besides the fact that many of the Jews died, so it wasn't a perfect salvation. With the Romans, it was not a perfect salvation. They destroyed Beit HaMikdash. Yes, in the end we got rid of them, but it's a terrible tragedy. With the Babylonians, they destroyed Beit HaMikdash. Yes, we got rid of them. We came back to Israel. We built the second temple, but it wasn't perfect. Later on, it got destroyed again. What with the Romans, the temple was destroyed, still destroyed for 2,000 years. So it's not a perfect salvation. Purim, perfect salvation. Now one Jew died. It was already signed and sealed in Shamayim. Forget about Haman. Haman is only a tool, a vessel. In Shamayim, there was a decree signed by Hashem. A final holocaust. Everyone is about to die. Children, women, everybody. Righteous, wicked. What was the decree for? Everyone was religious. One of the greatest time in history. How do we know that everyone was religious? How do we know? When Haman came to Ahasuerus, what did he say to him? There's this strange nation. They dress different than us. They speak a different language than us. Their religion is different than us. Right? He has a list. Tomorrow night, when you read the Megillah, read the Megillah. A different nation, different religion, different culture, different clothing, different language. Ahasuerus did not say, I don't know who you're talking about. He said to them, the Jews, Ahasuerus knew that the Jews are different than them. So if the Jews would be like the Jews of America, Ahasuerus would say, they are more going than us. What are you talking about? They went to the same university, they had the same food, they have the same names, they drive the same cars, they live in the same areas. Well, what exactly is different? What is the difference? They make Brit Milah, we also make Brit Milah. So what's the difference? Ah, but Ahasuerus realized right away, you're right, they are very strange. They're different than us. Everyone was religious. So what was the decree about? You're not going to believe it. The decree is that Ahasuerus made a party and 18,500 of the religious Jews with yarmulke and beard, there was no gilet yet, so everyone had a beard. So the Jews with their turbans, they went to the party. Jews going to a party of a goy? I don't get it. If Donald Trump will make a party in the White House and he will invite all the machers here from Borough Park and Flatbush, all these machers in politics, with their beard and peot, they won't go? Of course they'll go. They won't eat unless Trump will make a special glad kosher kitchen for them. Catering. So here, glad kosher, big tent by the White House on the grass. This is for the Jews that came from Borough Park. Right? Any rabbi would scream? No, the chief rabbi will join them. Why you left me out? Get me in. So for that we deserve a holocaust? That's the reason. That's the reason. Mordechai was standing by the entrance to the party and screaming to them, don't go in. And they did go in. And for that, Hashem signed a destruction. Hard to believe. So one answer is, according to your level, that's how strict Hashem is with you. If you're in kindergarten, you don't give a person a punch to the face. He's only 3 years old, right? So you give him a little smack in the hand. Hey, Hamudi, don't touch, please. A little bit. No, no, no. If you come to 25 years old and say to him, no, 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 don't steal. He's going to give you one, make you fly from the window. You have to be a little bit more aggressive with him. So according to who you are, that's how Hashem reacts. Medakdekim tzadikim kechut asara. Since everyone is Shomer Shabbat, since everyone is modest, since everyone is eating kosher, everyone is learning Torah, the Jews live separate from the Goyim, as you can see, they dress different, they have different names, different language, different everything. So they're not really breaking serious rules. But in their level, to go to such a Chilul Hashem parody, that's enough to have such a big punishment. But what is the real secret over here? Now I'll tell you the real answer. What was this parody about? How long this parody was, do you know? 180 days. Half a year. The parody was 6 months. Do you ever know a parody that ever took 6 months? Parody? Here in America, they have sometimes party to the next night. Meaning, people stay until the morning and stay for the day. And that's it. No, everyone goes. Six-man party. Every day you go back and forth, you go sleep home, you come the next day, you eat, catering, all kinds of booths, drinking good wine. So what's going on here? The answer is, Rabotai, this party was presenting the treasures of the Beit HaMikdash. The treasures of the Beit HaMikdash that the Babylonians took. Then the Persian ones, the Babylonians, and they took all the treasures of Beit HaMikdash from them. And Ahasuerus makes a show. So the show is about all these amazing things that the Jews have in the first temple. And the Jews, instead of ripping their hair off and kill themselves from pain, they go and drink wine and eat egg rolls. You understand? You want to tell me you're religious? They make a party, they show what they stole in the Holocaust from the Jewish temples of Germany or Poland. And now one rich guy that is showing it to in a big show in his mansion somewhere in Long Island. And he's inviting you as a religious Jew, and you come and you see all these things that they stole over there, and you're eating egg roll and drinking wine and l'chaim, whiskey, and you're not killing yourself. To be a Jew doesn't mean to be a robot that keeps the laws. Of course, it's better than nothing than to be a criminal who breaks the law. Don't get me wrong. If you have to be one of the two, be the robot that keeps mitzvot. But there is a much better option. Be a person that keeps mitzvot that is not a robot, meaning his heart is a heart of flesh, not a heart of a rock. Like it's written by the Navi, when Mashiach comes, one thing you will know, I will replace your heart of rock, heart of stone, with the heart of flesh, lev shel basar. Meaning the Torah already saying to us that some of us, at least some of us, will have a heart that is hard like a rock. Nothing penetrates. Stubbornness, ego, anger. I know the best. I'm the best. Looking at everyone down. That's a heart of a rock. Now, we understand now the miracle of Purim. Everyone was supposed to die. Everything turned around. Not one drop of blood spilled. Did you ever have a war like this? Now one soldier got hurt. The whole war, now one casualty. It never happened ever in the history, such thing. Never. Over here, how many anti-Semite Nazis the Jews killed? In the end of the Megillah, tomorrow night, pay attention. Over 75,000. Over 75,000 Nazis, KKK, all kinds of Nazis, One after the other, they took revenge against them. Imagine if there would be liberal Jews back then, what would happen in New York Times and all the other newspapers. Imagine what would be. Shame on you, barbarian Israeli soldiers. You just killed the head of the Hamas. Shame on you. Why did you have to kill him? Why didn't you put him in jail to watch television and get a degree and give him 10,000 shekel a month salary? Why? Why are you doing such things? Do you think they would let this? If half of our nation back then would be like today, they would let us go and take all the Nazis and anti-Semites and chop their heads off? You crazy? They would make riots everywhere. Look what they do to Trump. Now 1 second of rest. This Erev Rav. Who gives Trump all the problems? Who control the media, the television, the newspapers, the big companies, the big money? Putin. Who sponsor it?
Putin.
Not Putin.
No.
Not Putin.
Mr. Miller said Putin.
No. Who?
30 people from Russia. No, that's right.
Who does? No. No, give me names. Who? Who helped the Arabs? Who sponsored the BDS? Soros. Yimach Shimo v'zichro. This Soros. Worse than any Nazi, this guy. And he is a Holocaust survivor, I heard. You understand? One of the questions I would like to ask Hashem is why exactly save him instead of a righteous person that will help the Jewish nation, not fight against them. But I already learned, whatever we understand, we don't understand anything. We don't understand Cheshbonot Shamayim. Well, I do know that the Chilul Hashem that this guy does, that in Hungary they hung huge posters all over Hungary against this Jew. Meaning now all Jews are guilty of what's happening in Hungary. Just because of one guy. This is it. You understand? So, here you go. By the way, where do you think this source of liberalism come from? What? Why there's so many Jews that are liberal? Why almost everyone in Manhattan is a liberal? Why everyone in Manhattan voted Obama almost, or Hillary? Why? Where does it come from? Why the Jews are the most liberal people? Why? Why they always worry about this minority and that minority and the Palestinians and this and that? Why is it? Why they always worry about the gays and they worry about animals and they worry about all kinds of things like this? But the last thing they worry about, or ever, they worry about Hashem and the Torah. That they don't care. They don't care about religious people. They don't care about Hasidic Jews. They don't care about what happened to religious people. But they very, very worry what happened to the enemies of Israel and what happened to the enemies of the Jews. They very worry. Why is it? Where does it come from? Do you ever ask yourself where does it come from? Why is it that in Israel you have thousands of activists that when a murderer, Palestinian, go and kill Jews and someone shot him and killed him and his parents make a party now and give all kinds of sweets to all the people of the Arab village, these Israeli activists run there to the Arab village to participate in the mourning of the parents of the murderer. But they will never ever go to the house of the children who got slaughtered by him. Never. And it's always like this. Always. Not one time yes, one time no. Never in the history they cared about the Jewish blood that has been spilled in Israel. Never. But they always so worry about the blood of the murderer monster who went to the cribs and slaughtered babies. Who can explain to me where does it come from? There is any rational explanation to it? There is any logic here? Forget about Judaism. In any other country, if there's enemies of the country who make terrorism and they kill babies and innocent old people sitting at home, not soldiers, they come and kill them just for who they are. And the people of the country will take the side of these murderers. Did you ever see such thing? Nowhere. So how come by us is like that? How come by us, the Jews, is always like that? Half of our nation cooperating with our enemies throughout history. By the way, what is the biggest miracle in the Megillah? What is the biggest miracle in the Megillah? There are a lot of miracles in the Megillah. One miracle is that the Goyim already got the notes signed and sealed with the stamp of the king that Haman sent, and there was no internet, no Facebook, no CNN to announce that the decree is canceled. So it was canceled anyway, and not one of these Goyim attacked Jews. How did they get them all back to tell them, oh, no, you're not allowed? They had to send another letter that the other no order is all dismissed. But the question is, what is the biggest miracle? Maybe that the Jews had permission from Ahasuerus to go and kill all their enemies. And they killed over 75,000 of those Nazis, Amalekim. But what is even a bigger miracle than that? Who knows what's the bigger miracle? Who knows? Yeah. That Esther was chosen from all the women. That's also a very big miracle. First of all, you know, when you have a contest between all the pretty women in a country, it can be probably thousands of them, and they all want to be the queen, right? Every girl probably wanted to be a queen, so probably they checked thousands of them, and in the end, Esther was chosen. And Esther wasn't the prettiest, by the way. The Chazan said she was Yerakroket, meaning she was on a green side, yellowish, meaning not exactly the most beautiful. By the way, Mordechai, was he praying that Esther will be elected by Ahasuerus, or was he praying that Esther will not be elected? Huh? The only way to save the Jewish nation is if Esther will be chosen. That's the only chance we have here, politically. As far as efforts, there's no access to Ahasuerus to Mordechai to meet Ahasuerus. And the Jewish people don't have an army. And there's already a decree to destroy all of them. And there's nothing we can do. So now, the question is, here comes an opening now. They want to send a girl to be the queen. So we sent Esther. Esther is Mordechai is her uncle. So he sent her in. So you send her in hoping she will be elected, that she can be in the same room with Ahasuerus and talk to his heart, like Sarah Netanyahu. Someone told me she makes all the decisions in Israel. You know? So you want her to be the right-hand man of the king, no? She can influence him. What was Mordechai praying? That Esther will not be elected. Why? Why? How do you want your what do you call it? Nephew? Not nephew. Niece. You want your niece to go and live with a goy? It's against the Torah. How, by the way, Esther was able to be with Ahasuerus? It's against the Torah. We have a rule. What is the rule? Every mitzvah you have to do as long as it doesn't kill you. If the mitzvah is about to kill you, you don't have to do it. With an exception of the rule. Three mitzvot you have to die and never to break. One is idol worshipping. You can never ever bow down to an idol or anything like that, even if it will cost you your life. So you say Shema Yisrael and you die. Second, if they tell you murder someone else, if not, we will murder you, you cannot murder someone else. You're not allowed. So your life is over. Hashem puts you in this position, your life is over. The third option is gilui arayot, sex crimes. You have to die. You have an audience in case you didn't remember. There's an audience. They're watching you. You know. Maybe next time sell tickets for the show. Anyway, so the third one is, what is the third one? The third one is, what is it? Sex crimes. They tell you, this woman go and have relation with her. If now we'll kill you, you cannot agree. People do it today for free, with no fear. But according to the law, you have to die and not to agree. So now here comes the question. Based on that, how Esther agreed to be with Achashverosh? She should have died and not allowed. Now I know what you're going to say. Oh, to save the entire Jewish nation, she's allowed. No, that's not what it says. It says that even if there is pikuach nefesh, you're not allowed. Yeah, wait a minute. Don't go that far. They're not exactly from Ponovich here to understand what karka oilam. But the answer is, what it says that a person has to give his life not to agree when he commit the sin in action. When a man has a relation with a woman, who is the activist and who is the, what's the opposite of activist? Passive. Oh, passive. Who is passive and who is the activist? The man is the activist and the woman is passive. Meaning, a man cannot be passive and cooperate. A woman, she can be passive and still cooperate. Meaning doing nothing, like a statue, right? So the point is like this. Since they tell to the man, go and make a scene with this woman, otherwise we'll kill you, he has to be activist to make the scene, right? Bekum aseh, he has to get up and do something. That's you're not allowed. But if you are forced, they put a gun to your head. And you know, I don't move, nothing changed by me. I was laying down, now they put a gun to my head, I'm still laying down. So you're raping me, I don't want it, she probably cries, whatever the case was, but I'm not willing to cooperate. But if I won't cooperate, I will get killed and all my nation will be killed. So since I'm not cooperating, I'm forced, anus rachmana patri, I'm anused, I'm forced, I'm being raped. So I'm being raped, but at least something good is going to come out of it. The millions of my nation will get saved. But there is another explanation to that. This is the Pshat. The Zohar, the Kabbalah, which has all the secrets, say that Hashem replaced her with an angel, a shed, a demon, I don't know how to call it exactly, that looks exactly like her. That every time she had to be intimately with him, you know, a man has many wives. They don't get to see him every night. He goes and see all the wives in the garden, and he has this sharvit, his cane, and the one he gives the cane, and she grabs it, she was chosen for tonight. So sometimes you can be there 6 months and he doesn't speak a word with you. Yes, you're a queen, you have servants, they take care of your beauty, all day, jacuzzi, hot bath, cold bath, shopping by Macy's, Bloomingdale, whatever, I don't know all these names. But you don't see the king. If you get lucky, he chooses you. So already the miracle gets a lot greater. It's not that she's with him every night, that he has only one wife. Who's to say that in the next 6 months he bichlal will call Esther? That she will be able to talk to him if she's with him every day a little bit. A little bit, a little bit, a little bit. In 1 week she finished. But if she comes every 6 months or every year, it's a very big miracle you need here. So Hashem replaced her with like an angel, like you have Eliyahu Navi. Eliyahu Navi can come in any custom you want. As a poor man, as a rich man, as a Jew, as a goy. And we have cases like this in the Talmud. By the way, you should know that if there is a sin in the Torah for a man not to waste his seed. But there are two ways to waste seed. One purposely and one unintentionally. Unintentionally could be in the time of a dream. Person goes to sleep and he has a dream and he wasted seed. Purposely when he chose to make a sin. Which one of the two is worse? Obviously, when a person chooses to make the sin, is much, much, much worse, and the punishment is much, much, much greater than when a person is forced to make a sin, which he did not choose it right now. However, even when it happens to a person in a dream, he has a severe punishment. Why? Because it does not come at night in a dream that he dreams about a woman or an image of a woman that he has a relation with her, he doesn't dream that unless he look at the beauty of the women during the day. Every woman that goes on the street, in his office, in his school, in a, I don't know where he keeps looking at the women, stare at them, focus on their image. And because he thinks about all the time about women, he gets punishment measure for measure that it happens to him in a dream. And for that, he's going to be severely punished, even though it's considered b'shogeg, not intentionally. Now, in the dream, who are these women that comes? Sometimes he recognizes who they are. Could be someone from his school, from his college, and he dream about that he had intimacy with her. Sometimes it's a woman he never saw. He doesn't know who she is. Who are these women? Where are they come? Are they in the brain? And it's all some kind of fiction? Where does it come, all this thing? Or it's really something actually that happens physically? The answer is, there are these demons. Their name is, we're not even allowed to say their names. It's a very bad angel. Their name is Pei Taf Vav Taf. What's the meaning of these words? This word comes from the word Pitui. Lefatot, to seduce. That's the name of those angels. And they have permission to come in any image that they want. Sometimes they come in the image of someone you're staring at and you're looking at. Sometimes they come in an image of someone you don't know. This is a perfect example, how these angels can come in any image they want. Can come as Esther or Rachel or Sarah or Christine. You understand? So what's the solution against it? One is to watch the eyes. Second, to pray every day that it will never happen. And if a person does it, it helps. It stops. It can stop for 10 years, 20 years, not even once. Never happened. But there's another thing. When a man makes a lot of sins, before he become religious, girlfriends, this, here, there, doesn't care about holiness. And all of a sudden he becomes religious and he stops. No more wasting seed, no more women, no more goyot, no more watching dirty films. He stops. The Satan is going nuts, crazy. Why? It's a war now that if the Satan loses it, he lost a soldier. That's it. Because all the wicked people are soldiers of the Satan, whether they understand it, whether they don't. The Satan do not choose righteous people to do his dirty job, only wicked people. So if you were used to hurt another Jew, then you know that you're guilty of something. Megalgelim chova al yedei chayav. You don't, Hashem did not make you kill someone in an accident randomly. If a Jewish boy, God forbid, died because you drove a car and he jumped into the road and you're the one who killed him, even though the police came and they say, well, you're not guilty, here's your license, go home. We feel bad for you. They're not arresting you, nothing. They see you did not do anything wrong. You drove slow, the kid ran. What can you do? You're not Superman. You're not guilty maybe here, but you're very guilty in Shamayim of something. That's why from all the Jews in Flatbush, you were the one who chosen to execute that little kid. Now you have to sit home and ask yourself, what have I done wrong? That from all the people in the world, Hashem chose me. You know the famous story that happens in Lakewood, right? 10 years ago, approximately. There's a man that he drove on Lakewood, and there was an old man crossing the street, and he hit him. Accident. And he killed that man. Goy. He killed the goy. The police found out that it wasn't his fault, so they did not arrest him. But he had very serious conscious issues. Couldn't go back to work, to learn, cannot function. So they told him, go to Rav Chaim Kanievsky. He's a big Rav in Eretz Israel, one of the biggest. Go and consult with him. So he went to Rav Chaim Kanievsky. And Rav Chaim Kanievsky told him, don't eat your heart too much. Maybe you got the merit to do the mitzvah of erasing the memory of Amalek. Some of these goyim are Amalek. And mitzvah, to get rid of them. It's written in the Torah. Think that that's what happened. And don't kill yourself over it. Because Rav Chaim Kanievsky says like this. I'm trying to get into his head to understand. If I'll tell him, well, you're guilty of something, he's never going to have a rest. He's going to kill himself. He's never going to go back to learn Torah. He's not going to be able to function. He will live with guilt. That's not going to get you anywhere. You cannot reverse now the wheel back. It's happened already. You cannot bring this guy back. So what's the point? Do tshuva anyway. Ask mechila. And that's it. Move on with your life. But maybe you got lucky. Maybe you're one of the only Jews in the last 2,000 years who had the merit to make this mitzvah of erasing Amalek, the children of Ammon. So he went back to Lakewood. He felt a little bit better. He met a very holy rabbi. Now he wanted to buy a house, him and his wife. So they called a real estate broker. And they asked, "Does any houses around here available?" They say, "Yes, yes. There's a house. Someone just passed away. And the house is for sale. The children are selling the house. Can we see it?" "Yes." They took them to the house. They moved into the house. They go in. What does he see over there? The picture of the old man he killed. The man that he killed, that's his house. Look how Hashem directed them there. Now he's in the house. He said, "It cannot be Hashem brought me here for nothing. Why did he bring me here?" You know, smart learners, they know that nothing happens for nothing. So they started and said, "Can we open the closet? Can we check?" Say, "Yes." They open, all kinds of things. Then there was one like closet in the floor. And they pull it up, like a drawer. They pulled up the drawer. It's like a slick that they hide things over there. Nazi magazines, hundreds of them. Pictures of Hitler, all kinds of Nazis items. This guy was a Nazi. Who was the Nazi? Germans, Amalekim. Amalek, like Rav Chaim Kanievsky told him, maybe you were lucky to erase the memory of Amalek. I want to ask you a question. After the Holocaust, the Jewish people decided that the Nazis are Amalek. Who told them that? How do they know? How do Jewish people know that the Germans are Amalek? If you want to tell me, because there you never saw in the history someone so cruel like them, the answer is wrong. The Arabs are much more cruel than them. The Arabs are more cruel than the Nazis. Not all Arabs. Some Arabs. Not all Arabs are real Arabs. Children of Ishmael, the Torah say, Pere Adam, wild beast. Look at ISIS, what they do to people. They go with a tank over a person. They make him powder. Unbelievable. Their own people, their own cousins. They caught him with a glass of wine in a house, a bottle of wine. You know how they torture them for having a bottle of wine? It's unbelievable what they do to people. Did you see how they stone people? How they throw in the women drugs and break their head? They have no heart. So what do you see? You can tell me what the Nazis did the same thing. Ma, they didn't burn babies. They didn't torture Jews. Of course they did. They took a person on a wheelchair and threw him from the fourth floor. Well, it can be more cruel than that. So the terrorists from Ishmael and the Nazis are the same. This is a beast and this is a beast. Right but wrong. Why? Because the Nazi will never agree to lose, to have even a scratch for a Jew. He wants to kill all Jews, yes. But if I have to get hurt, if I have to break my arm to kill the Jew, I won't do it. Let him go. I'm not going to suffer to kill him. I hate him very much. I can't look at him. I'm dreaming to burn him alive, yes. But I won't agree to chop my legs to kill 10 Jews. To be on a wheelchair for the rest of my life. As much as I hate them, I love myself. I let them go. If you come to a Nazi and say to him, you can kill those 10 Jews in one condition. From then on, we chop your legs and you sit on a wheelchair all your life. Or we throw you from the window and you die with them. He won't agree. But the Arabs not only would agree, he will choose it. To die with killing them. It's an honor for him to die by killing a Jew. 10 of them will die to kill one Jew. You have no idea how they're happy to kill a Jew. Gay, kid, not kid, woman, doesn't matter who. You never had in a history such thing. Who besides Amalek? Amalek. Why God hates Amalek so much? That's last night lecture that I gave. The Amalek has nothing to do with the Jewish nation. They search for them in the middle of nowhere. We don't have a mutual border. We don't have anything to do with you. You're searching for us always to attack us on the road. And not only that, you jump into a boiling bath to cool the bath. But you are burning. As long as I cool the Jews from Avodat Hashem. That's Amalek. Amalek, numeric value, dollar. That's the Amalek of today. What cool people in Avodat Hashem? The greed for money. People that are so greedy for money, that's what makes them go away from spirituality. Every generation has his own Amalek, metaphorically speaking. So going back to what I started to explain. So, the Esther, she's now in the palace of Ahasuerus. And you need a very big miracle that he will choose her. So what is the miracle of, or the one of the biggest miracles of the Megillah is that Esther was 5 years with Ahasuerus. And he still does not know she's Jewish. And none of the Jews went to tell about her. There were no liberal Jews back then. No traders, no lefties.
No Obama.
Nobody came to Ahasuerus. I have an urgent message for your majesty. Who are you? My name is Mr. Cohen. How can I help you? I have very important message for you. What is it? Your wife. She's hiding. She's a Jew. What would happen? The king will give him a special green card. Here, Mr. Cohen, you are my friend now for giving me this information. If you ever have a problem, call me. That's my private line. You don't have to go through my assistant. So, Mr. Cohen, how are you so friendly with the king Ahasuerus? You know, we did some business in the past. He's not going to say I'm a trader. I gave him inside information. No. 5 years, Esther is there. Now one Jew told about her. I want to ask you a question. Why Esther is hiding her identity? What's the problem to say that she's a Jew? You think Ahasuerus will let her go because she's a Jew? Yeah, the opposite. These non-Jewish kings, they'll die to have a Jewish wife. Many of these goyim, they run after Jews non-stop. All the children of Trump, they all ran after Jews. You know what the joke of the election was? Very sad joke. What was the guy named? The liberal? Sandy. Bernie? All the children of Bernie are goyim. And all the children of Trump, or some of the children of Trump are Jewish. I mean, the grandchildren of Trump are Jewish. And the grandchildren of Sanders are all goyim. That's the sad joke, and that's the story of the American liberal lefty Jews. They're all assimilated, and they all become goyim. And then they come to Israel, to the Western Wall, to bother the few kosher Jews who are left in the world, in the Western world, that they pray, to bother them over there, that they won't be able to focus. The reform. We want to pray! Since when? You marry dogs! Well, since when you care about praying? You marry dogs, you eating dogs, you behaving like dogs. We want to pray. The Kotel belongs to all of us.
It's not true.
You understand what's going on here, Rabotai?
It's not true. Kotel doesn't belong to them.
The Kotel belongs to Hashem. And Hashem, that's his house. And who does Hashem want in his house? Who do you think he wants? Honest, decent, modest women who read Tehillim and eat kosher and send their children every morning to yeshiva? Or all kinds of women that became goyot, merry goyim, eat pork, eat on Yom Kippur, mechalel Shabbat, and the list is all the way from here to Zimbabwe. Who do you think Hashem wants in his living room?
Not only once, Rabbi.
Huh?
Not only if he wants to, but even if he, somebody does all the bad things you just said, he still has to keep the mitzvot and go there. Not only he wants it, it's his obligation to go there.
No, it's not true. There's no obligation to go to the Kotel. You can go all your life without going there. It's no obligation.
I'm sorry, but the same thing. If I do all the bad things, but do I still have obligation to put tefillin? Even if I eat pork?
Yes, tefillin, yes. But to go to the Kotel, it's privilege, not an obligation. You can pray anywhere you want. You don't have to go. You know how many Jews never went to the Kotel?
He's not allowed.
He's allowed, but why are they coming? That's the question. Why are they coming? They're coming to pray, I will be the first one who call them, welcome. Here, come and pray. My, a lot of secular people come to pray. A lot of other goyim come to pray. We never tell them don't come. Do you know how many black people from Africa I see every time I go to the Kotel? They put this paper yarmulke and they pray, probably to JC. Who are they praying to? We never kick them out because they don't come to disturb us. They come with their innocent belief in JC or in God or whatever the case, and they pray. And that's when it says, Ki beti bet fila ikare lechol ha'amim. But these rotten monsters, they only come for one reason, to make provocations. That's why they bring video camera, and the women comes with yarmulke on their head, and they supposedly now bring Sefer Torah. They grab the Sefer Torah from the kosher minyanim. Their filthy hands touch it. You understand? And they know it's going to cause fights, and right away it's going to be in the lefty news channels. It's very nice to be famous, that you come to fight the religious people.
They're all trying to come back.
Yeah, you can join them, by the way. Okay, it's good to laugh at least a day before Purim. So anyway, Rabotai, Mishinichnas Adar Marbim Besimcha. Anyway, Rabotai, so I just want to conclude this at least. So Purim, now one drop of blood spilled. And all the Jewish people made 100% full repentance, which never happened in a history. That's why Hashem loves this holiday so much. That even when Mashiach come, Purim will still have the same significance. Why? The Gemara says in Masechet Megillah, Gdola, Asarat Atabat, Sheisir, Achashverosh, Venatan Leaman, Yoter, Mi 48 Neviim, Veshevah Neviot. Translation, wait, English. The removal of the ring, meaning the stamp, of the king Achashverosh and giving it to Haman that he can do whatever he wants with that to the Jews. He can sign any letters and send it away and put posters everywhere that you can kill the Jews and take their property and don't worry about it. You're not going to be prosecuted. This moment in history was such a great moment in history that he was more productive to the Jewish nation than all the 48 prophets, male prophets, and 7 women prophets that lived in a history. All the speeches they gave, all the books they wrote, everything that they did is not coming to the level of Achashverosh giving his stamp to Haman. Why? Because Achashverosh, once he gave the ring to Haman and the Jews realized they're all going to die in a few months, there was no more nonsense. Nobody stayed modern Orthodox. Nobody stayed secular. Nobody did anything wrong. Do you know what they did? In the holiday of Pesach, instead of doing Leila Seder, Leila Seder, tonight Leila Seder. Go buy some meat, some things, nice suits, enjoy the holiday. You're going to die in a few months, not tomorrow. In the month, in the night of Leil HaSeder, 3 days they were fasting, and they closed all the yeshivot, the books, everyone went in the middle of the city, they all put ashes on their head, and wore a sack, all the children brought tehillim. For 3 days everyone was screaming and crying and bending down on their knees, screaming to Hashem to forgive their sin. Everybody. There was not one traitor, not one secular, not one lefty, not one liberal, none. Everybody together screamed for their life and made tshuva. That's one of the highest moments in history. The only other moment that comes near it is the moment we got the Torah. That everybody screamed together, Na'aseh v'nishma, be'am echad, be'lev echad. Right? That's it. How many moments like this you had in the history? Do you know any other generation that all the Jewish people made tshuva? Where? When? Never happened. Never happened. So that's it. There's one more thing. It's very, very interesting what I'm about to teach you now in the next 10 minutes. And I think, time is running out as usual. But it's very, very interesting to know what I'm about to teach. Very interesting. In the Midrash, we have Midrash Rabbah. Midrash Rabbah on the Torah, on the Tanakh. On Megillat Esther, Midrash Rabbah, chapter 10. This is what it says. Vayikach Haman et ha-levush ve-et ha-sus. Haman thought that the king Ahasuerus asked him, what should I do to a person that I'm interested in his favor, that I owe him? Haman thought, who does he owe more than me? We buddies. Take your alfet and your crown and your special white horse and make him go all over the town and then there's going to be a special announcement. Kach ha'yaseh la'ish asher ha'melech hafetz bi'ikaro. This is what's going to happen to the person that the king has an interest in his good, in his favor. So he said, take it right now and do it to Mordechai. He got the shock of his life. Imagine the moment that after you become the most powerful person in the world. A minute before that, Haman was the richest guy in history. The richest. He was so rich. He was richer than a king Ahasuerus, who was in charge of 127 countries and collecting taxes from 127 countries. And Haman is wealthier than him. Imagine how wealthy. Every person in the world bow down to him. Everywhere he goes, people bow down. Except one, the chief rabbi of Israel, Mordechai from the Sanhedrin. The Jew with the beard and the peot and the kippah and the tzitzit. Every time he passed by Mordechai, it burns his heart. This is what he said to his wife. V'chol ze enenu shoveli. Everything I have, all the money and the power, and everyone bowed down to me, and everyone kiss up to me, and I have the stamp of the king. I am the strongest guy in the world. This Jew destroys everything. Pin in the neck. What was the old job of Haman? He was a barber. A lot of the Bukharians, they start in a barber shop, then they push gold. Gold into the barber shop. I've been in some places. Half of the store is barber, other side buying gold. 2 or 3 years later, $10 million in 4 years, 2 lions in the front. Baruch Hashem, you had a lot of haircuts, Mr. Borokhov. Oh, it's not from the hair. From the other side of the store, buying gold. What do you mean buying gold? They buy gold from people who sell it cheap. They sell it expensive based on the rate of the gold. Listen carefully, Rabotai. Vayikach Haman et ha-levush ve-et ha-sus. He went to Mordechai, When he got to Mordechai, Mordechai started to shake from fear. Hitler is here. I started to ask you before, I almost forgot. You always forget. I sometimes remember, but you forget. I ask you, how the Jewish people decided that the Germans are Amalek? Now, the answer is, the Gemara say, in Masechet Megillah, page 6, the Gemara says that Yaakov begged Hashem not to let his brother Esav succeed. Said this Esav, if he will succeed, this is Germany. Remember, this was written 2,000 years ago. There was no Germany in the world. But it's written clearly in the Gemara. This is Germany of Edom. Who is Edom? Esav. That if they will go out to the world, they will destroy the entire world. And then the Gemara said there are 300 tribes in Germany of Edom. And if you check in the encyclopedia, in the word Germany, you read over there that there was a person named Bismarck. And he united the 300 barbarian tribes. Westphalia, Schlesia, Bavaria. There were different tribes. And every tribe has a different independence, different governor, different everything. And he gathered all of them to the German Republic about approximately 150 years ago, or maybe more. And after he gathered all of them to the German Republic, later he became Germany. Later he became Germany. And if you check in a encyclopedia how many tribes Bismarck got together into one country, 300 exactly. Just like the Gemara say, miracle. It's one of the proofs in my Torah and science field. So, this is Germany of Edom. So, Germany is Esav. Okay? So, there is mitzvah to erase Amalek. Haman, who is Haman? Haman Agagi. Who is Agag? The king of Amalek. That Samuel, the prophet, killed after Shaul, King Saul, failed to do that. He kept him alive. Yesterday I explained in my lecture, how is it possible that after the Jewish nation destroyed everyone of Amalek, the worst one they left alive? How can it be? If United States went to Iraq to fight Saddam Hussein, and they killed so many Iraqi soldiers in the war, and in the end, they got to Saddam Hussein and say, Saddam, Mabruk, go eat kebab in the market. We let you go. The American nation and the Europeans will go crazy. Why did you burn billions of dollars in a war and you got to Saddam and in the end you released him? Doesn't make any sense. Do you know any stupid person will do such thing? And Shaul was a very holy, smart king. How in the world he left Agag alive? How can it be such thing? You want to know the answer? Watch last night's lecture. It's online already. So we have to understand now what's going on here. So Mordechai is shaking. Why? They tell him Haman is here. Haman with his soldiers comes with the horse. Imagine the fear. Mordechai is in yeshiva learning. Nityare ad meod. Aya Yosef v'talmidav lefanav. He's the rabbi and all his students sit in front of him. Amar lahem letalmidav, he said to his student, Rutsu v'ibadlu mikan. Run for your life before they kill all of you. That you don't get burned from me. Meaning they came here for me. Why should they kill all of you for nothing? At least save yourself. Haman bala argeni. He came to kill me. They say to him, Rabbi, if you die, we die with you. They didn't run for their life. We're not going to leave you here alone. You die, we die with you. We don't have life without you anyway. You die, we die with you. Amar lahem, im ken na'amod b'tfila. Say, okay, you know what? Let's stand and beg Hashem. Let's pray. That's the best we can do. V'nipater mitoch tfila. Let them kill us while we are praying. It's very good. They kill us in the middle of our prayer. We come to Shamayim in a very holy level. Right? What were they learning when Haman was outside? What were they learning? What subject? Mitzvat HaOmer, the laws of the Korban HaOmer. On the second day of Passover, there's a special ceremony to do the Korban HaOmer. Special wheat that they cut, they do it, and after that, all the wheat up to now, it's permitted to be used. It's called Kemach Yashan. Yashan. But you need Korban HaOmer for that. Now I want to ask you a question. There is Nazis walking around preparing the death of all the Jews. The Jews are going to be all dead in moments. There's already a decree that was signed and sealed. There's never in history that a signature of the king ever got canceled. Ever. So all Jews know, unless Hashem is going to do a clear miracle, we're all dead. Now when you know you have X amount of weeks to live, what you supposed to learn? To die on Kiddush Hashem. We're going to die on Kiddush Hashem, right? They're going to kill us. We're going to scream, Shema Yisrael. Let's learn how to die in the best way possible, that at least in the next world we're going to have a very high level for it. Who cares now about the Korban HaOmer? About the wheat? What do you care about this now? You're going to die now? And you say, okay, I want to learn the law of tefillin now. What is it ever? You're going to die in an hour. Learn something that it's the moment now. So what did they learn about the Omer now? They have the head to learn about Omer when they know they're supposed to die any minute? Amar Lahem, Aman came in. He said, what are you doing? They say, we learn. What do you learn? The Nazi is asking, what are you learning? Say, Mitzvat HaOmer. So he started to ask him all kinds of questions. And, you know, this is the Midrash. Now the question that we have to ask, Aman said to them, Your Omer, overcame my 10,000 pieces of silver that I gave to a king Achashverosh. In the end, Haman said to the Jews, I gave him so much money, pieces of silver, so many, 10,000, which has a tremendous value, to give me permission to kill the Jews. And you, what did you do? You learned about this Omer, הקומץ שלכם הכריע, the little that you did, overcome what I did. That's what Aman said. The Gemara says, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us mitzvat machatzit ha-shekel before Haman gave the money to Achashverosh. That we will have also this merit. You give him money, Hashem gives us mitzvah of giving money. No. So according to the Gemara, what canceled the bribe that Haman gave to Achashverosh? The shkalim that the Jews gave, the machatzit ha-shekel. But according to this midrash, their omer, what they learned about the omer, that's what canceled Haman's decree. So which one of the two is correct? The answer, both correct. No contradiction. That's true, and that's true. But that's not what I wanted to teach. You know, sometimes you tell a long story to get to the punchline. What's the punchline? The punchline is that they never, ever gave hope. None of them were depressed or sad or sit home crying, I'm going to die. They were all sure that Hashem will make a miracle for us and will stay alive. So what are they learning about? Regular Torah. I'm not going to learn how to die on Kiddush Hashem. Because I'm not going to die. They never lost hope. They were not giving up hope. Because when you give up, you learn how to die. That's it. I give up. When a person said to the lawyer, come quickly to my hospital, I want to write a will. What do you understand from at that moment? that he already agreed, that's it, I have to die. I'm not going to come out of here. But if the person says, no, don't call the lawyer, I'm not writing any will, what do you understand from that? He's 100% sure he's coming out of the hospital. If he will or not, that's a different story. But what's in his mind right now? I have full confidence I'm coming out. Meaning, I'm not even going to care what's going to happen with all my money that I hid over here and I hid over there and I hid under the ground. Why? Because I'm coming out of here. If I had 1% doubt, right away, lawyer, come here. I have this and I have that and I bought this and I have stock here and I have this. And if you go to my house, you dig a hole and you find this. Okay. Why? Maybe I'll die. Today people make wills when they're 40 already. With a war like this, who knows what's going to be next? Why? They're not sure that they stay around. Mordechai is teaching them the laws of kmitza. That belong only when Bet HaMikdash will be built. Well, you're going to die, you worry about Bet HaMikdash now? Mordechai the Tzaddik is not giving up. Or what people say on the street. The Torah say there will be Bet HaMikdash. For us, it's reality. We continue to prepare for Bet HaMikdash. That's it. When Haman saw that the Jews by them are business as usual, they learn as usual in yeshiva. I'm going to kill all of them. I already send notes to everyone. And they learned regularly in a yeshiva. How can it be such thing? What's the purpose of learning? What's the purpose of learning? Imagine a kid, God forbid, in first grade, second grade, sixth grade, doesn't matter, that the doctors gave him 48 hours to live. And now he says, I want to go to school and learn. What do you want to learn? I want to learn history and math. Tell him, you have 48 hours to be with us. There's no need to learn. You're going to be eaten by the worm soon. You want to learn? What is it going to give you learning math now? You understand? There's no logic here. Mordechai, Haman is thinking, look at these people. Nothing can break their spirit. Nothing is scaring them. This is an eternal nation. Haman understood, I have no chance against them. Why? That's what he told them. You're learning. As usual, cancel every effort I made to give Achashverosh to give me the power to kill you. Haman did not give up, Rabotai. The Jewish nation did not give up. Haman had to surrender in the end. Any questions? Yes.
What about between 100% faith and unrealistic?
That's a very good question, and everybody has this question every minute of his life. The question, in case you didn't hear, what's the balance between having 100% confidence in Hashem to be realistic? So, I tell you why you're asking me this question, because you have a common mistake that almost everybody has. Almost everybody. What does it mean to have 100% confidence in Hashem? What does it mean?
It means that you don't have a fear about your future.
Does it mean that I'm confident that everything I want Hashem will do for me and give me? Is that not what it means? No. It means that I am confident 100% that everything that will happen to me is the best thing that can happen. If I love it, very good. If I hate it, doesn't matter. It's still very good for me. Surgery is very good. Who wants surgery? Who wants to be cut? Who wants a hand of a doctor going to his heart? Nobody wants it. But that's the best thing right now that can happen to me. Otherwise, tomorrow I'll be dead. Some people, jail was the best time for them. The best thing for them. Yosef, he went to jail. Without the jail, he will never make it to Paro the king and become the treasury of the entire world for 8 years. No one in history controlled all the money in the world for so long like Yosef did. No one. Greenspan, few years. Bernanke, few years. From then on, I stopped counting.
Putin?
Huh? Putin, 20 years, 30 years. How long Putin, since he was a spy for the KGB, until he became the richest man in the world and the most powerful man in the world? How long? 20 years, 30 years. How long Putin is in power?
How many more years?
Another 20. No? So, I give him 20. No?
Maybe.
So how long is that? 50?
Maybe
40. 100. You're willing to be quiet now? 100. What? Come on, enough with you. But Yosef, from age 30 to age 110, every person in the world needed his mercy to have food. Control everything. All the world was in his hand. Imagine this, the power. Imagine the power he had. And why did he get it? Because he went to jail. And he met the ministers, Sarah Mashkim, Sarah Ofim, and he solved their dreams. It was all a part of a wonderful plan for him. But he always knew it's all for good. But other people probably thought, why such a righteous person went to jail? Why? Nobody knows why. After everything will be done, everything will make sense. That's for sure we know. But it doesn't mean that I'm confident that I will always have what I need. No. Maybe Hashem won't give you what you want or what you need, supposedly. Not necessarily. Maybe he'll take away what you have. So, being realistic means I'm realistic that I can be sick one day. I'm realistic that I may lose my money. I'm realistic I won't ever find shidduch. It's all in the back of my mind. But as a Jew, as a believer, I pray and I believe that Hashem will give me what I need. And if that's what I need, he'll give me. If not, no, that's it. I once gave a series of lectures about confidence in Hashem. Over there I explained it widely. One thing you have to know, that real righteous people, they don't pray for anything specific. Don't give me wealth, don't give me shidduch, don't give me anything. They don't pray for anything. Everybody can swear that shidduch is something good. Not always. Everyone swear that money is a good thing. Not always. Everyone swear that health is a good thing. Not always. This is the point here. So what's the right way to pray? What's the right way to pray? Hashem, do everything you want that will make me the closest to you as possible. That's what you have to pray for. Let's see you a hero praying like this from now on. Nothing! Make this deal for me. I want this house. Please make us win the bid. Please this. I want this shidduch. Please make the shidduch work out. Please make my father-in-law change his mind and agree to take me. Nothing! That all could be poison for you. Just to pray for one thing. Hashem, I don't care at all what you want from me, what you're going to do. Only I'm begging you, whatever you do, do that it will help me to be as close as possible to you. So you know me. You know my nature. If you know me as an ungrateful person, it's not good to give me a lot of money. Because I'm going to be ungrateful. The more you give me, the more I'm going to get punished eventually. If you know me as a grateful person with the right ideology that knows how to give tzedakah, so then obviously it's very good to give me money because I'm only going to do good things with the money. I'll build yeshiva, I'll help the avrechim, I will make more CDs, I will spread a million books like this to every Jew. I will do wonderful things for you. So you know me. You know what's going to happen when I become a millionaire. I think I know myself. How many poor people say, Rabbi, when I'm going to have money, you're never going to have to worry about anything. And as soon as they make their millions, they kick me like a dog. Yes, of course. I will never forget my first experience was with a guy. I'll tell you a story and maybe we'll finish here. One day, I was standing on King's Highway in Brooklyn, Be'avonotai Arabim, Sodom and Gomorrah. King's Highway, Hashem Yirachem. Why did I do in King's Highway? I had a friend back in time that had a store there called Coco Kids. You know this story? It's a long time ago. Coco Kids. They were selling kids' clothing. Coco Kids. So I went to that store. As I came out of the store, I'm standing in that intersection. It's very close to Coney Island, one block. As I'm standing in that circle over there, right there, I meet a guy from Israel. Who is this guy? He is some kind of relative of mine, very, very far. Very, very far. He's actually a relative of my cousin, okay, whatever you want to call it. But we knew each other from Israel. And I'm talking to you about approximately 20 years ago, approximately plus minus, 20 years ago. I meet him on the street. What's going on? What do you do? You came to America? You're visiting or you're here to stay? He said, unfortunately, I'm here to stay. Why? Why are you here to stay? I went bankrupt in Israel. I had a little restaurant in Israel. In Israel, it's very difficult to own a business. And I owe 150,000 shekel to people. And soon they're gonna arrest me. In Israel, it's not like here. If you owe money and you don't pay, you can go to jail.
Bankruptcy,
yes. But in Israel, if you give a check and the check bounces, you have very serious problem. Right away, they freeze your bank account. They go after all your assets. Not like here, you have to beg the person 10 years. Can you give me a new check? Different world over there. Gestapo, when it comes to this. So, I meet him on the street, young guy, in his 20s. I gave up the business and I came here. So what are you going to do? I want to go into real estate. I heard a lot of Israelis here in real estate make good money. I say, well, you have anything in mind? He say, yeah, I want to go to Jamaica Avenue over there, where all the Israeli own offices, and I'm going to start working. I have very little money and I have to start. I was married already. I think maybe even had one kid back then. So I say to him, I'm going to give you an advice which office to go to. Don't go to the office you wanted to go. Go to this office over there. He will never steal from you, never cheat you. He's a very honest person. I know him very well. He used to live with me. We used to be roommates. He's not a religious person, but he's a very, very honest person. So it's very good because a lot of the other people that will steal from you your commissions, your work, and you don't want to go to him. Okay, thank you for telling me. I sent him over there. He did work there. He did start to make good money. And then back then, I started to give lectures to the Israelis in the real estate office there. Remember the story that I once told you that I used to go there every Friday? So he was one of them. Now we meet again. So I made him religious. Him, his wife. So I made him religious, and I gave him an advice that within a year made him a rich guy. In 1 year, he already became rich. Today he's a multi-millionaire. You know, he probably has $200-300 million. But back then, he had a few hundred thousand dollars. Not bad, no? For someone who's only 1 year in America, paid all his debt. Oh, a year or two later, he already had his own office. Started to buy real estate. Owned buildings everywhere. Buildings with 8 tenants, 10 tenants. Very big tycoon. After he became rich, I said to him, back then I was still learning in yeshiva. Learning, teaching. So I had a group of guys, Israeli guys in yeshiva. They don't have any money. They learn all day Torah. They want to buy tefillin, they don't have money. They want to buy shampoo, soap, t-shirt, underwear. They don't have money. Shoes, suit. They need a few hundred dollars here and there. So I made a gmach. Gmach assistant. So I said to all the people, I started to make Baalei Tshuva. So I said to them, if you can give your master to my gmach, We'll take care of the guys. So he said, no problem, I'm going to give you 12 checks. 12 checks, $260 for 12 months. Very good, it was a lot of money for me. Wow. One guy can survive off this money, maybe two. Very good. So he gave the money. In the meantime, he continued to grow. So when the 12 checks expired, he was already 10 times bigger. Back then he was maybe $1 million, now he maybe have 10 million. So what do you expect after that? That you should make the 260, maybe 1,000 or more, no? He said to me, I have to stop the checks to the Gmach. I said, why? He said to me, it's enough, I gave this and that. 2 days later, I found out, he went to some synagogue here for Rosh Hashanah or Yom Kippur, I don't remember exactly. He bought one aliyah, $26,000. After he told me, no, come tight now, I have to stop. He bought an aliyah, stop, to go up to the Torah 1 minute, $26,000 in one of the shuls here. This is the way people are. The more they owe you, the more ungrateful they will be to you. The more they owe you, the more ungrateful they will be to you.
Did you call him reform?
No.
Did you call him Obama?
No.
Did you call him liberal?
No, I'm very happy that he's still religious until this day.
Don't talk later. I'm sure you called him. I'm sure you called him.
No, no. Obama is the worst already. The Banim of the Banim. He's not there yet. Baruch Hashem is nothing near Obama.
Did you call him Obama friend?
One thing for sure, he's not a lefty. Okay? So bottom line, Rabotai, not that he's not going to give tzedakah. Don't get the wrong impression. He may give a lot. But to whom? To strangers, to people who did nothing for him. Why don't you give to someone who saved your eternity? Why are you going to be such an ungrateful person? Imagine you come one day in front of God after you leave the world and you brag, I gave so many millions to tzedakah. And you're going to get such a smack. Boom! Shame on you. What? What happened? I was very generous. Everyone who knocked on my door, I gave. Yes, you did. Well, what about the one who took you from the garbage, from hell for thousands of years? You spit at him, you stuck a knife in his back, and you went to strangers and gave them all the money. You think it's mitzvah? Think about it. Your own father is on the street and you went to help strangers that you never heard of? And now you're calling yourself a great Baal Tzedakah? Very good. Yes, yes. Don't get me wrong, you can give everybody. I didn't say you don't have to give. No. No, I did not say not to give others. I did say, if you give, you have to start from who you owe the most.
I want to give the safe side. No.
You understand? If you want to give $1 million to tzedakah, you have to give most of it, by far, to the person you owe the most. And then the rest you share between all the others. Don't be a fool, let the Satan fool you. Why do you think the Satan is a stupid angel? He's very, very experienced. He already knows you generous and you want to do tzedakah. If he knows you stingy, he's going to kill you not to give. But if you already know this is your nature, you want to give. People come to your office, you write checks. The Satan cannot stop you from giving. So what the Satan does? Direct you to someone that you owe nothing or to horrible causes. That the money basically goes to the garbage.
That's what we do when people come.
No, I didn't say, again, you don't get what I'm saying.
No, but that's what you're supposed to do. Why you didn't tell me before?
What I'm saying to you right now, Abotai, is you have to understand one thing. Sometimes the people don't give tzedakah, you know why? Because they want to buy another apartment. And then they don't give tzedakah because they want to buy another apartment. And then and every time you tell them we need help, they're going to say, no, I'm in the middle of a deal, I'm tight now. Of course, you're always going to be tight because you're greedy. You will never stop buying more and more and more. And some of them, you know why they collapse? Because they're over greedy. They buy property and they keep taking loans. So they always assume that everyone will pay the rent, and real estate will always go higher and higher. As soon as there is a tiny crisis, 2, 3, 4 months, money is not coming as usual. They're beginning to default on their loans, penalties, problem, lawyers. Psh, collapse. Many of the people in real estate, they went bankrupt, not because real estate is bad, or not because there's not enough profit. They wanted to swallow the whole world in 1 month. I tell it to all my students in real estate, don't buy too much. Buy, be in control, leave enough money to live for a year or two, that you never run out of money, because then you have to go in the black market and pay 30% interest. Don't do these things. Once you have enough money, a lot, buy another one. And then when you have more, buy another one. Don't buy and loans, and then you collapse and you take all the money of all the people with you to the garbage, like many of them did. I have a friend in 2007, before the crisis of 2008, when all the real estate collapsed, remember the 20 banks went bankrupt? The bank system and the mortgages, Fannie Mae, all these things. So I tell you what, I came to Rabbi Aderet. He was still in Monsey back then, before he moved to Great Neck. I used to be very, very close with him because we were mamash almost like neighbors. We used to pray together in the same shul. We even had a shul. We opened a Sfaradi shul together in Monsey for 2, 3 years. So what happened? I came to him and I said to him like this. It's recording. I said to him, tell all your people to get rid of most of the real estate. Because real estate was booming back then. And we made a fortune. He said to me, why? They make very good money. I said to him, in less than a year, everything will collapse. He said, what makes you think so? I said, very simple common sense. The banks started to raise their interest rate. The interest rate, every 2, 3 months, another 0.25%, another 0.5%. People in America took loans, but they make X amount of money, 40,000 a year, 50,000, 60,000. Most Americans, middle class. The energy prices became double. People used to pay $500 a heat, it went up $2,000. It's very expensive. Oil went up. I said to him, now, people that used to pay $2,000 mortgage, it's going to go up to $3,000, $3,500. Extra 2% a year interest on a big loan, hundreds of thousands. People don't have the money. Between energy prices and the monthly payment, millions of Americans will go bankrupt. They're not going to be able to pay. The banks will have thousands of homes every month to put on the market. It will crush the market. One person in Muncie was a very big Balzdaka. He had a mortgages bank. He sold his business, got a nice amount of money, and a month later everything collapsed. Why? He was a very generous person. Every person who came knew he always gave the best checks. Non-stop tzedakah. Imagine this. If he would be a stingy guy, Hashem would make him collapse with everyone. Hashem, so he gave so much tzedakah, he gave him in 1 minute all his tzedakah, everything, 10 times more. He got, I think, if I remember, $200 million for his company, which 2 months later he would go down to $10 million. Not even. So here you go. So people want to buy. So I have a friend. I told him, how many houses you own right now? He said, about 20. We renovate, and we're going to sell them, and then we keep buying. I said, don't buy anything. Just get rid of as many as you can. What? There's a lot of opportunities. I said, trust me, don't buy. Everything will collapse right now. You don't want to have so many houses that they're all going to go down 50% of their level in 1 year. You're not going to get out of it. So, Baruch Hashem, he listened. When it happened, he had maybe 4 or 5 homes. He lost. Yes, he did, but he did not get wiped out. People who were 20 times bigger than him, they ran away to Israel. They left 50 homes to the banks. There's no point. We own a mortgage more than what we're going to sell this house. They said to the bank, take the 50 houses, took whatever they could and ran away. It wasn't worth it for them to even try to save it. Who got stuck with all the hundreds of houses? The banks. Why do you think the banks went bankrupt? All of a sudden they have 10,000 homes for sale and nobody buys. This is what happened. And all this is, it's going to come back again. Same thing will happen and again and again. Same thing the stock market. Keep going higher and higher and higher. Boom. And when it collapses, it will collapse within weeks. Everything will be wiped out. Don't forget, it was 6,000 points and now it's 26,000. The companies of the United States do not worth four times more in the last 20 years. They don't sell four times more. They don't own real estate four times more. Where they all of a sudden the the value came from? Value has to come from profit, from business. You increase your sales, you sell a lot more. You have your bank account is loaded with hundreds of millions. So the value of your company goes higher. Here it's all fake. All fake. Same thing, same sales, even less. But the company stock is four times, five times more. Why? United States government print money and keep buying stocks. Even now, when it went down 2,000 points in 2 days, what do you think happened? Right away, they bought billions of dollars every day to keep bringing the market up. Why? If the market would crash, this is the end of the world. Because in real retail, nobody makes money anymore. Go to a furniture store, see how many people come a week. Nobody walks in. Everybody buys online today. People ordering it from Israel, ordering furniture from China in a container. It's 10 times cheaper. Nobody buys in the stores. Stores pay rent, electric, workers, so much expenses, insurance, these taxes, delivery. So much problem. Today you don't need all this. Everything is online. You have one storage, you stuff it with stuff, and you don't even need to. You get from your supplier, you get an order, you make an order, that's it. Directly from the supplier, your supplier sent to your customer. You don't need to even worry. Every United States partial, what do you call them? The post office, USPS. Do you ask them? They have 10 times more mail now than 10 years ago. 10 times more. You're wondering sometimes how your mail doesn't come until 7 p.m.? They cannot fulfill the amount of orders they have. They don't know what's going to happen. They worry they're going to lose control. Why? Because everything now is by mail. All the packages, these, free shipping, Amazon, everything, free shipping. So people buy online, and it's save time, and people don't want to go and search online, they see it, and they can return. There's nothing to lose. I don't like it, I return it a week later. You know what people do? They order four pairs of shoes, try them, the rest they return, they send back. Better than to go shopping. Who still shop? The sick people. That it's a habit for them. It's an addiction. What are they going to do? Sit home? It's boring. So they go to the mall, like to go here and there. You know, women with their husband's credit card. It's a way to have fun. The internet is not fun. Here I go to the mall, I go in a coffee shop, I eat, I sit, I meet people. No, fine. They do it for the fun, not for the actual shopping. But besides that, business is very bad. Speak to retail owners, they'll tell you what's going on. Everything became online. You understand, Rabotai? Any questions before we finish? Yeah.
Who's going to be the prime minister of Israel now?
Who is the prime minister?
What's going to be with...
It's not that easy to bring Bibi down. Mm-hmm. Bibi has teams that work for him day and night. I won't be surprised if the leak about the judge and the prosecutor were exchanging texts between them came from Bibi's people. Bibi has people everywhere. You know, he learned a lot from Putin. You understand? It's not going to be easy to bring him down.
Rabbi.
All the lefties barking nonstop, 20, 30 years. Bibi is still smiling and smoking his cigars. Rabbi. Bottom line, Hashem decides who's going to be in charge. In case Bibi falls down, I think my guess would be there is a guy that retired from politics. But he will return right away. His name is Gideon Sar. Yes, he became a semi-Baal Tshuva now. Yeah. And I have a friend that we have a mutual friend, me and him, that he gave him some of my CDs, and he's very into Judaism now. He learns, he listens. So if he will be a prime minister, it can only good can come out of it. But we still have some time. You see? In the meantime, Bibi is mourning, his dog died. Let's give him a week rest. See, he's, you know, sitting Shiva on a dog. Yeah. Why? Even religious people love to go to parties. Come to religious people and say there is a wedding of this billionaire. And there is a wedding of this Bachur Yeshiva in a school, in a high school, in a basketball court. Some of the guys in our yeshiva, they married in a basketball court. You make chuppah and the basket is right above your head. So why? They could pay $15 a meal and they pay $700 a person. So they took a fancy place. So now you ask religious people, go make a survey here in Flatbush, or in Borough Park, or in Muncie, or in Lakewood, or anywhere you want. Which one of the two weddings you prefer to go? To the wedding of the Bachur Yeshiva, that they will give you white chicken from 5 weeks ago, and a little sweet cucumber, or you want to go to the fancy wedding that you're going to have the best stuff on earth, and the best music, and the best band, and everyone comes with the show, Purim gown. Which one of the two the religious people are looking for? The simple wedding that has nothing to eat, you just come to dance and make Chatan Vekala happy? Or they want to enjoy the show with a good blue label and, you know, socialize with some important people? Which one they will be attracted to? You know the answer. Nothing has changed. En chadash tachat ha-shemesh, Shlomo HaMelech said. The nature of the people will always remain the same. Our job is not to fall into our desires and nature. That's it. Sometimes we will fail, sometimes we will succeed. So I just want to remind you, tomorrow it's a fast day. It starts from dawn, which I think is about 5:30, 5:40, check in the calendar, and stops after the reading of the Megillah. But officially it stops about 40 minutes after sunset. So whatever the sunset is, you can add 40 minutes, you can eat. But the problem is that you're going to be in shul and they start reading the Megillah and you're still fasting. So it's hard for you, you're dizzy, you can go and drink water. You don't have to suffer. Well, before they read the Megillah, if you feel that you're dizzy, you can go drink something. Once you hear the Megillah, you must listen to every word. You cannot skip one word. Unless you have your own Megillah, that it's written like a Sefer Torah, kosher Megillah. In case you skip a word or two, you were dreaming about your stock situation and about your mother-in-law that coming this Shabbos or something like that and made you forget what the Chazan say, then you can go reverse and read from your Megillah and continue with him. But if you read from a printed Chumash, or printed Megillah, it's a problem. You're not Yotzei Lidechova if you skip. You have to listen to everything. What else?
About the stocks. In 2008,
Rega, one second.
The sales of Apple used to be $37 billion. And today, it's $229, exactly $6.
You're such a genius. You chose a company who invented something and they'll sell. By the way, you just put salt on one of my wounds. I once bought 5,000 shares of Apple when it was very nothing. It was much very cheap.
Which one you want, IBM?
Listen, one second. And the guy told me there are two ways to make money in the stock market. Buy, sell, lots of headache. You want to get my advice? Don't do anything. Just keep this Apple sales, the 5,000, and wait 2 years. I say, why? He say, my estimation is that Apple will increase their sales in the next 2 years by at least 1%. 1%. And he already gave me how it's going to be the effect on the stock. And that's going to be more than you can ever think to make by buying, selling. It went to $110. And then it went to $1,000. Same thing Google, when it came, it was $80. He said to me, just buy Google and don't do anything. That's it, just sit and wait. It's going to go to $1,000. He was right. But you think you know the best. You want actions. You don't want to buy and sit 1 year and wait. From 80, he went down. One guy in Muncie bought 1 million shares of Google for $80 a piece. And he went up to 600-700, he sold. From 80 to 600-700, almost 10 times more. He became a billionaire. Later I heard he lost all his money, but, you know, money comes, money go. What's important is what you take with you to the next world. Okay, one more thing. Now it's the time to give matanot la'evyonim, meaning you can make a shaliach, you can give your rabbi, you can give us, we give it to the guys in the yeshiva. You can do that. You can do it yourself if you know any poor people. Sometimes you're embarrassed to give them money. Wow, you think I'm poor, you're giving me money. Some people have ego. You know, even you come to do them a favor, they get angry. I remember once my wife gave brand new clothes to a poor family, and the woman over there started to scream. She got angry. She got clothes with a tag on it. Why? She got insulted. What make you think we poor? One man, your husband is in yeshiva. You drive such a car that's falling apart. You live in a rented tiny apartment. We thought you need the clothing. But she had ego. What did it help her? 20 years later, instead of the clothing going to her constantly, it never went to her anymore. Why? Because I told my wife, if she gets upset, it's not mitzvah. Don't give her anymore. Give someone else. 20 years, she could have got clothes from all the rich people who buys it, and they get bored and they don't even wear it. They buy 5 pairs, they wear one, and the other 4 stay with the tag. Some of these clothes, you can go back to Century 21, Macy's, and get back the cash. That's the interesting part. So some wives of Avrechim were wearing gowns of $800 when the husband doesn't make $500 a month. Where does it come? From the rich people. They buy, and they don't know what to do. Rabbi, do you know anybody that needs a coat, need this, need shoes, needs... Okay, well, brand new stuff. But the ego. So you not always want to give it directly to the people. That's why you can make a messenger to give it for you. You have to give at least 2 kinds of food to at least one person. We usually give either a small bottle of wine and something. Now, if you give people things that you cook at home, unless you're a famous rabbi that people trust you, they're not going to eat it. Think about it. Because they don't know where you cooked it, what's the level of your kashrut. So better not to do it. Buy them things that have a certificate on it. They see the kashrut, they decide what they want to do with that. Better not to buy all this candy, poison, all these kinds of stuff. You have to give mishloach manot to someone you know that will make a bracha. Someone that will not make blessing, it's no mitzvah to give them food. So only give it to someone that you know that when he eats the food, they'll make bracha. You understand? So here you go. This is now in Purim, you have mitzvah to hear the Megillah tomorrow night, and you have to hear it Thursday morning. After Shachrit, mitzvah to hear Megillah again. Some women, they have special minyanim for women. Women can read the Megillah between themselves, if there's no men over there. But there's an obligation to hear the Megillah. Women were also part of the miracle, and they must hear the reading of the Megillah. It's mitzvah, you know, to publish the miracle that Hashem did to us. Any questions before we finish? Anything I forgot? Oh, everyone wants, there's not that many books. The books that we have in Hebrew in America are books that I brought myself in suitcases from Israel. So all I could bring is 100, and yesterday was my first lecture since I came back to Israel. Half of them are gone. So there's going to be maybe tonight and maybe another night, they all will be gone. The next time, we will make a big order. All the books that we printed in Israel, almost all of them are gone. By tomorrow, not one will be left. We have to make a very big order. The problem with this order is you have to lay out a lot of money, which I don't have. People do not donate enough. I don't have money, not for CDs, and definitely not for the books. The books are costing a lot more than CDs. It's expensive. It's a good print. It's good pages. It's not garbage. It's hardcover. You have to pay the graphic, you have to pay to edit, to go over it a few times, to check, you have to lay out the money up front. Believe me, there's a lot of headache. And if you want to make an order now, you need to put $20,000 to order another shipment until you get the money back. Then you have to order again. So constantly you have to lay out a lot of money. I wish I had the money of all these big organizations that have unlimited amount of money, but I don't have. So grab it while you can. It's the price of it is $20. We don't even put it on my website, as you can see, because I don't have inventory. Once we're going to have a nice inventory, we're going to put it on the website and people will be able to order it online. Baruch Hashem, yesterday we started to translate it in English. I assume that in about 3 to 4 weeks, it will be finished and then we will be able to make it in English. And then hopefully after that in Russian and maybe some other languages. So, you know, I will give you my word that anyone that you know that needs chizuk, needs to become religious, needs to be better in religion, this book is ideal for him. Ideal. It's based on 24 years of experience, based on lots of lectures that we did in many topics. We chose the best parts that already been proven that they work. We're not gambling. We only put things that for sure in my eyes I saw that made a huge impact on people. And lots of explanation about the Torah, the oral Torah, the purpose of life, stories that happen over the years, miracles that happen, a lot of interesting things. If you want to know the index of the book, listen to my lecture from last night. I went through the entire list. We will see you Bezrat Hashem next Tuesday. We're coming close to Pesach. We don't have that many weeks left. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen.